In this video, two subjects. At first, the circuit that I published 2 days ago was pure experimental in a somewhat sloppy video, but anyway, it was this circuit. And you can see in that video that the LED switches on and off at a certain moment, and it works this way, that the LED switches off when the voltage here gets too high. So there is a very simple adaptation to this circuit when we see how this works, and that's this circuit. And now I have, say, connected here a voltage divider. With that voltage divider you can set the voltage where the circuit switches off. And it was not my purpose, but it worked very good in the 12 volt up to 18 volt range. So my idea was use this, for instance, to charge a car battery or nickel cadmium batteries, here all in a row. I will tell more about it later. And I found that it worked good, though I have to make the real life test. And the idea is to charge all these nickel cadmium cells in series and then see whether the relay switches off properly when the end voltage, end charge voltage, is reached. Anyway, again back to that circuit. It's very, very simple and it works, and the relay also does not get hot. Sorry, that the N transistor does not get hot, the BC547. It's a medium power transistor. The DC, the resistance of the relay is the DC resistance, so when you measure that with an ohms meter, is 260 ohms. And the circuit has a kind of, say, strange behavior, because when you add a supply voltage here of 9 volt, the relay is activated. But when you add to the charge circuit a voltage of 12 volt, the relay is not activated, and it has to be activated because it must switch off when the voltage is too high. So that's why I made here start button switch. You only have to push that once and then the relay is activated and the whole charge process starts. Of course, there must be a spring here that the contacts, say, flips back to the open position of the switch. Anyway, I'm gonna test it further. Gonna make a new video. But I'm more or less absolutely sure that it will work. Only problem could be that the relay on 1/100 of a volt starts to hammer, doesn't switch off immediately. So that will be a next experiment. Anyway, I publish the circuit now for everyone interested to do experiments. And this was my second project this evening. Here all kinds of nickel cadmium batteries. And the first advice is don't make it in this way like I did it here. I've used all old nickel cadmium batteries that were more or less salvaged through the years, but they were good. I tested them all. You can test it very easily by looking whether they still give after all those years a tiny voltage. And the voltage is not depolarized, so not reversed. When you have a nickel cadmium, old nickel cadmium cell, and the polarity is reversed, throw it away. The bad thing is also here that all these different nickel cadmium cells, all 1.2 volts, have a different ampere rating. So powerful cells are combined with, say, these cheap Chinese nickel-cadmium batteries, and that's also the reason why you see them here mounted in between the fierce nickel-cadmium cells. So not a bunch of fierce nickel-cadmium cells first and then a bunch of weak cells, but and you can do this in this way always, more or less always, when the voltage that you want to take out of such a, say, battery bank, the current that you want to take out of such a battery bank is low. And that's my idea. I only want to, say, take 50 milliampere or so out of this battery bank. When the current gets too high, the powerful cells inside this bank will try to give more current. They will push up the voltage to the weaker cells. So that's the reason, when you want to make this in a proper way, always use identical cells and use an even number. I've used here an uneven number. That's not very handy, but anyway. The battery bank, again, I have not mounted a fuse, though it's advised. And you can use such a battery bank for all kinds of experiments, especially for meter circuits. When you study old schematics of the 1970s, 1980s, 1990s, meter circuits often need a positive and a negative and a zero. That's logical. I cannot explain that now. I don't have enough time to do that anyway. You can test preamplifiers with it, because such a battery set is noise free. Of course, other noise can be picked up, electromagnetic fields can be picked up, but that's another type of noise, and I especially mean here the noise created by the current and the irregular movement of electrons in a circuit. That can cause a typical type of noise. But anyway, when you study that in a more scientific way, there are also, say, problems in sensitive audio preamplifiers when they were driven with batteries. Good advice is to solder everything. When you want to make such a battery bank with springs that have to hold all the batteries in position, that's not a good idea. There's always contact resistance in these springs, and especially the contact resistances in such a battery bank can cause noise. That's why I've soldered everything here with pieces of copper wire, so that I can take out all kinds of voltages here. Here the positive, here the negative, and somewhere in between there is the zero. The only example that I have in my mind at the moment about a negative bias is the classical example of a triode tube or a pentode tube that needs on its grid, especially the power tubes need a negative bias on their steering grid, and that's demonstrated here. So here the positive, say 200 volts, here we take out the signal, here we send in the signal, and the grid gets a negative voltage. And I have to say that is very, very critical in such a tube circuit. You often see here in the a cathode lead, a resistor, and an electrolytic capacitor that bridges it, that gives a kind of, say, also a kind of negative voltage to the grid. But I found in practice that with, say, audio amplifier tubes, the better way is to give the steering tube a real negative voltage. Not by mounting here a resistor, etc. Of course, there are different opinions about how to generate the negative grid voltage anyway. That was more or less all to tell. The moment I'm charging this battery bank, it charges. It's supplied now by approximately 20 volts, 74 ampere out of this power supply. I don't go higher in my charge current than 100 milliampere. That will be far enough for such a setup with a combination of, say, weak nickel cadmium batteries and strong nickel cadmium batteries. 100 milliampere is a good voltage to pump this whole unit up to the maximum voltage for a nickel cadmium battery. So on a certain moment the voltage has to be switched off anyway. Well, that was all to tell. Thanks for watching. The circuit again. And when you want to solder two nickel cadmium batteries, it's a kind of bad way to do that, because in professional situations they are not soldered because they heat up too much with soldering. They use other techniques to adhere the electrodes. Anyway, when you do it, use a very good quality 100 watt soldering iron. And of course, when you can weld them, often they are spot welded. That's what I wanted to tell. They are spot welded in professional situations, nickel cadmium batteries, when they make a pack for tools, etc. They are spot welded, but of course I don't have a spot welding machine.